Okay, so now we're going to go over the third step in revenue recognition, and that is determining the transaction price. Many times this is actually pretty straightforward. As an example, if I buy a $30 sweater at the mall, it's pretty easy. This transaction price is going to be $30. However, there are certain situations where determining the transaction price can be a little bit more complicated. First of all, whenever there's variable consideration, in other words, there's something that where there's going to be something dependent on, so like maybe a bonus based on certain things or discounts or other things where it's not exactly known how much is going to be paid in the end. Also, if there's a delay in payment, we have to consider the time value of money. And then sometimes there will be non-cash consideration. That's basically when non-cash items are exchanged. And then finally, sometimes there's consideration that is paid or payable to the customer. And so we have to think about that situation as well. All right, let's talk about variable consideration first. There are things that may create some variation in the ultimate amount that the customer is going to pay, and that's going to determine the transaction price. So basically, it's just not known at the time of the transaction. If it's not known, we still need to record the revenue, but we have to figure out a way to record it that takes into account this variable consideration. I just list some common examples there. So how do we report an amount when the exact amount is not known? There are really two methods that are acceptable. You can either report the expected value, or you can report the most likely amount. These actually aren't quite the same thing. Expected value is probably what we would consider like an average or a weighted average, especially when there might be a distribution, or if you think about a bell curve. If there's a distribution of the consideration that might be paid, expected value probably makes a lot of sense. Alternatively, you could use the most likely amount, and this is a situation where there may be one outcome that is more likely than other outcomes, and maybe that's the best predictor of what is ultimately going to be paid. I want to be clear here, though. The idea is that we're recording revenue now, even though final payment is not going to come until later. And so the question is, how much do we record revenue, record for revenue currently, even though final payment is not going to come until later, and for sure it's not known. And secondly, in order to record this, the firm must be reasonably assured that it will be entitled to the reported amount. In other words, if let's say there's a performance parameter that's very unlikely to be met, it would not make sense for the firm to report any amount related to that bonus or whatever that might be tied to performance. And so, again, there has to be this idea of reasonable assuredness before we would be able to record this additional revenue at the time. Again, this is at the time where the service takes place or good is exchanged, but where final payment is going to come later. All right, let's go through an example and that might help. So let's say that we're a firm and we have consulting services that we provide for a client during the month of January 2018. We receive a flat fee of $15,000. But we also may receive a bonus depending on the client's performance over the next 12 months. We determine that there's a 55% chance that we're going to get a $10,000 bonus, a 35% chance we're going to get a $5,000 bonus, and a 10% chance that we're going to get a $1,000 bonus. And so, again, this is a variable consideration situation where there is going to be a payment. We're reasonably assured there's going to be a payment. We just don't know exactly how much that payment's going to be. So what price should we record? We have $15,000 as a flat fee. I hope it makes sense that that absolutely would be included in the revenue. The question is, how do we handle the bonus? If they choose to report the most likely amount, the most likely bonus is that $10,000 bonus. It's likely to occur 55% of the time, which is more likely than the other two combined. And so it might make sense to report the most likely amount. If they chose that method, then the revenue that they would report would be the $15,000 flat fee plus the most likely bonus of $10,000, which means they would report $25,000. Again, this is what would be reported in January 2018. They also could choose to report the expected amount. This is an average. And in this case, it would really need to be a weighted average. And so the expected bonus would be the weight of the $10,000 added to the weight of the $5,000 added to the weight of the $1,000. So this is just a fairly straightforward weighted average calculation. And so the weighted average, or the expected bonus based on the weighted average, would be $7,350. And so they would, in January 2018, report the flat fee of $15 plus the expected bonus of $7,350 for a total of $22,350. Notice in both cases, they're going to be, well, in the bottom case, it's never going to be exactly $22,350. And in the top case, 45% of the time, they're going to get a different amount than $25,000. Again, this is what you record at the time the sale is made. Later on, when the actual payment is made, of course, there would be adjustments, but we can record the revenue now without having to wait for the actual outcome. A second complication is if there's the time value of money. In other words, if there's a delay. And so if there's a delay, basically the transaction price is a little bit complicated due to timing. Specifically, if there is a significant delay, then U.S. GAAP infers that there must be a financing arrangement. And what that really means is that there's sales revenue, which is sort of the present value of the payment, and then the interest revenue is any amount above the present value that you end up receiving. So basically what they're saying is you made a sale and then you financed that sale, so a portion of whatever amount you end up receiving is going to be interest revenue. They infer this. Again, even if there's no formal arrangement, we still infer interest because of the delay. Again, the key though is that it has to be a significant delay. So two things to consider. First of all, significant really should be any delay that is material. In other words, if the fact that there's a delay in the payment is something that's important to decision makers, then you should apply TVM to the payments. And just sort of as a practical matter, anything over a year is going to require it. But, you know, we should sort of take a step back and just say, okay, you know, I think practically speaking, if there's a 5-day delay, that's probably not material. But let's say it's 9 months. A 9-month delay, depending on the interest rate, absolutely could be material. And so a year is sort of a hard and fast rule, but you could apply TVM to payments even if they were to occur less than a year away. And then secondly, the firm must use the most clearly determinable or most reliable imputed interest rate. In practice, basically, it's going to be comparing the sales price of the good or service if it were to if we had a current price, and we'd have to compare that to some sort of inferred discount rate, usually using similar debt for the firm. Let's use an example for this one. Let's say a manufacturer sells a custom-made piece of machinery on February 1st, 2018. The company agrees to accept a payment of $400,000 on August 1st, 2019. The manufacturer's internal borrowing rate is 6%, and while there's no comparable sales equipment, the manufacturer estimates the market value of the machinery is $350,000. So how would we record this sale? So first of all, because it's more than a year, the delay is significant, so we don't have anything to worry about there. The second piece is we have to figure out which method or which path to getting a present value is going to be more reliable. Is it the estimated market value of $350,000, or is it the firm's internal borrowing rate of 6%? And you're going to see here in a second where, depending on which one we choose, we actually would get a different number. So I've laid out our two choices and how we would apply TVM to this problem. If we believe that the market value is more reliable, then we have the present value as the current market value of the good. And so basically then we'd need to solve for the yield. Our N is 1.5 or 1.5 years, and the future value in both cases, regardless of our assumption, is going to be $400,000, the amount that's paid at the end in a year and a half. But what we're solving for in the first case, we'd be solving for the yield. If we believe that the internal borrowing rate is more reliable, we actually are given the yield at that point, and we would need to solve for the present value. The key is that these two approaches, these two choices, do give us different numbers. And so, again, part of the process of using TVM is figure out, well, which one of these is going to be more reliable. Again, if we solve for it, we see that the yield, if we use the market value, is 9.31% for the internal borrowing rate, If we were to solve using that, we see that the present value is $366,523. This next picture here kind of gives you why this becomes important. And so we can see conceptually, this arrangement has total revenue of $400,000. We have to figure out how much of that is going to be allocated to sales revenue and how much of that is going to be allocated to interest revenue. The sales revenue is the present value of that $400,000, and then the interest revenue is basically the amount above the present value. If we believe that the market price of the good is most reliable, then you can see that the present value would be $350,000, and that's what we would record as sales revenue. And then we'd record interest revenue of $50,000. Alternatively, if we believe the borrowing rate is more reliable, we would record $366,523 as sales revenue, and then $33,477 as interest revenue. Again, this is the choice that we're making. I think in this case, it's likely that the internal borrowing rate is more reliable given that it is a custom-made piece of equipment. And so we're just going to kind of move forward assuming that the borrowing rate is more reliable. And so the initial entry, as we already discussed, we have the note receivable, or you could conceivably have an account receivable, but it's for the face amount of $400,000. The sales revenue that we record, as we can see, is the present value calculation, $366,523. The remaining amount goes as a discount on the note receivable. And that discount, just from a big picture, really is the amount that eventually will be recorded as interest revenue. But similar to interest expense or other times we've been talking about interest revenue, you earn interest revenue as time passes. And so essentially we start accruing interest revenue as time passes, and that discount will be amortized as we accrue that interest revenue. Sort of like what we've been doing all along with any other amortization tables. And so as we move forward now, we have to accrue interest revenue at the end of the fiscal year. Again, we issue the note or receivable, whatever it might be, on February 1st. And so on December 31st, 2018, we need to accrue interest revenue because time has passed and we want to make sure that we record that on our financial statements. And so in this case, we start with that present value or the initial carrying value of the receivable and we multiply it by 6%. Again, 6% is our more reliable discount rate. And of course, we accrue 11 out of 12 months for a total of $20,159. And so on December 31st, we have a debit to our discount and a credit to interest revenue. Again, we're amortizing the discount as time passes or as we record the interest revenue. So with our final entry, we need to record the last bit of interest revenue along with the payment of the note receivable. And so again, the initial amount of the discount was $33,477, which captured the amount of interest revenue that we would record over the life of the note. We already had accrued $20,159, which means we need to accrue $13,318 as the note is repaid during 2019. And so for the entry, we have the interest revenue of $13,318 along with the amortization of the discount of $13,318. And so both of those amounts, of course, offset, but now the discount balance is zero. Of course, now we also receive the note, and so the note gets paid, we get the $400,000, and the note receivable comes off of our books. And so that just sort of closes out the entry and closes out the TVM for this note receivable. There also is non-cash consideration that we need to consider as part of this third step in the revenue recognition process. Again, non-cash consideration is when goods and services are exchanged and there's no cash that's part of the transaction. Generally speaking, you will use the fair value of the asset or service received when we recognize revenue. And so if we can reliably estimate the fair value of the asset or good received or asset or service received, then we will use that to recognize revenue. If for some reason that amount is not determinable, then we can use the fair value of the good or service that we provide. But again, most of the time, it's going to be the fair value of the asset or service that is received. Finally, we're going to talk about consideration paid or payable to customers. We're not going to spend a lot of time here, mostly because it was really covered in accounts receivable. So there's a discussion in accounts receivable with regards to discounts and consideration paid or payable to customers. And so that's really where that's going to be covered a lot. And so in this chapter, it's just more of a conceptual based discussion. And really, the concept is you really should report your expected amount. And so you have to think about the likelihood that the discount is being taken. And so if it is likely that the discount is going to be taken, then the firm really should only recognize a net receivable as revenue rather than the gross amount. And again, if the net receivable, you just basically have sales revenue at the net amount, and then there wouldn't be any discount sort of taken off of that. However, as a practical matter, most firms will recognize the gross receivable as revenue and then subtract off sales discounts from that. Again, the guidance really is that whichever is most likely is what the firm should do, but as a practical matter, most firms will just recognize the gross amount.